Thank you, everyone. Good. So next up is Peter. So Peter's going to talk about Zipstax. Peter's a blockchain engineer at Diode. He's a business administration background, so developing into programming. Currently, he's developing blockchain-based decentralized APIs with a Diode team, working closely with the CTO Dominic. Take it away. Post a hustle to like Twitter, intent, maybe that will work as a fire mechanism to get it.
How do you describe it? Oh, no, it's not streaming to the internet now, but I'll log it later.
I wish there was an easy tool to like just do that. Look like the results of that paper is like, oh, having you know, like there a lot of times where I know there should be like some pretty simple like bit twiddling solution for like this, and all I care about is like these inputs and outputs. Like I know what these inputs and outputs should be,
right.
And either I don't care about the rest, or I feel like it should be obvious what the rest are.
Right.
I wonder if there's like a Python library or something, but that just plugs into ZQuery.
Yeah, well, you should look at the blog post, because the guy wrote all this stuff for us.
But I mean, one other thing that I've been thinking about is like,
it's a good problem.
So, you're using Z3's like and it's Boolean logic stuff, right? So you could have a case where like your instructions for your programming language or for your for the instruction set. There's like a slight semantic difference between that and the and
you have to specify it. But this, I think this is done. Like, there's stuff out there to put a project that's called Super, and I think there's like similar ideas of this being able to specify. People have done it for
fun. Yeah, I mean, well, usually when I'm like faced, when I guess programming, I face some problems like, oh, I have these things and I care about the output. It's like something that I feel like I should know or be able to solve myself fairly easily.
How do you set this up?
I can turn that on. Oh, it's on mute. If you want to mirror it, or do you want to separate it?
Oh, you do.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. It's on the You don't want, you know, you plug in the computer. Could be bad, you know?
I'm not an engineer, it's bad for the IO. And I think I'm doing here. Today I'm going to share about this other role resource perspectives, the things that are different in the PM work. And I think it's interesting maybe because the authors use just to demonstrate the techniques that I have in the work. And then I'm going to introduce our project, Bad Lateral. Here's my Twitter and yeah, so if you don't have questions, afterwards you can just pin it over here. Okay, so first I'm going to talk about what is Eclipse Attack. And then I'm going to introduce the different particular work and how it works. And next I'm going to talk about the Eclipse Attack for monopolized collections and the bi-table poisoning and then by memory threads at a time. Next I'm going to introduce our project and the five news that to solve this problem. So what is Eclipse Attack? It's an attack that malicious actor may deploy multiple nodes on the network. It aims to control the victim's access to information and then the attacker can turn on the victim's view of the information in blockchain, which is the information of the blockchain. So if the attacker controls the information about the blockchain, then they can do some double spending or the selfish mining. So you can see the picture. The red are malicious nodes. So they are got the yellow node. So the yellow node couldn't know the right information. So how human works, it's used the Identia network. I'm not going to talk about the Identia because Oscar introduced the Identia network before, so I just explained to you. So they use the XOR matrix and the node state and the Identia outcome message to exchange the peer-to-peer network information. And the difference in here is that they use Identia to find the peers, not to find the content. Then they use the node IDs, which is 64 bytes TCP SA ID. But they didn't check the unique node IDs corresponding to the unique network addresses, so the user can generate multiple node IDs with a single address. And then the network conditions, they use UDP for exchanging peer-to-peer network information, and the UDP message is timestamped, so the other node will drop the UDP message if it's older than 20 seconds. Then they use TCP to exchange blockchain information. the people next to us, like, simply can be out of it. They even said the limit for incoming and operating connections, so you can use 25 for all incoming connections, and 25 for all operating connections. So how do they store network information? They use the DB and the table. The DB one is for long time usage. There is no longer size limit, so you can save lots of network state in the DB, and the other one is the table. The other one is the memory, so it will refresh when the user removes the computer or the router. And there are 26 buttons, plus 16 inches in the iPod. So, on the design, where the log is in the buttons, they use the loglist function to map the nodes to the buttons. They hash the node ID and then compare the significant bits of the connections. It's called some patient. There is a highest significant of nodes in the buttons. You can see the yeah, so that's the time it takes for the traffic to go to the exit of 16 bus. And if you can see, there's which one is the 16th entry. Yeah. So the probability of getting to the bucket from the 6 minus 1 is that entry. So you can see the time is very high, right? Okay, so on the populate the data structures in the DBM network. So there are six hardcoded good nodes. So if there is no there's empty nodes in DB and the table, so DBM will use this hardcoded good nodes to find the peers. Then there's a bumping process to populate the node state. And see the first time they check the node is whether the node is exists. And then they check the DB because if the DB records the response, the final or the DB response even respond the POM message within the 24 hours, they will ping the protocol. And then if they test the check, they'll add the node to the memory panel. And the other one, they also send the service from the UDP message. So if somebody, some here in the node, they'll come back and call the pumping process. And a nice line is the lookup. It's just like the company. So I think next is the so how do you see in the data? First, they check if the table is not empty. If the table is not empty, they just return. They won't see the data in the table. And then they'll check the lookup. They'll check every hour for this thing, as I see. And they'll call the lookup function. So how do we how do I select the peers to connect? They select half from the offer and the half from the table, but in this section, they also talk about the test persona, which is aimed to populate the parameter and the table and creates the outgoing TCP connections to other nodes on the different. In the test environment, there are a discovery test and the dialog test. And the discovery test is called the academia lookup to find the target to dialog. And the dialog test is then to make the TCP connection to the target. So there are some checks in the balance. Yeah, first check if it's not currently out, and then it's not already connected, and it's not the node cell, and it's not blacklist, and now ready to dial. Here I'm going to introduce how to then map techniques that help optimize the connections. So since there's no limitation for next peers, they become an algorithm. So they can just use the to fill the next peer's missing connection to fill all incoming connection. Yeah. And they do all attacks on the tags reboot. And the tags will reboot for many reasons, just maybe out of memory or out of child of electricity, yeah, something like that. So the whole technique focuses on the answer because the answer includes the table is empty, so they can use this. And you can see it has no incoming and outgoing connections. and they just started using it in the internet. So a taker can just create figures and express node items for all genome connection. And the experiment with those results is that they use 1,000 attacker node IDs, which is in New York and the Boston. And they at least attack 49 nodes of 50 tests. So it's like 98%. And then they try to use the different type out. Yeah, so they set up the thing in the setup. And they finally use the FTPS. So they suggest eventually enforce an upper limit on the number of incoming TCP connections, which because they use this to for at least a head. I think if you update to 8 incoming connection, TCP connection, add 1 million. Next is the techniques attacked by table poisoning. So the table poisoning is that they want to fill the whole table buckets with their graphical IDs. So, first they craft the node IDs for the buckets, and then they insert the tag nodes into they insert the node IDs into the victims, because the victim will clean the node if they didn't clean or they didn't respond in 24 hours. So they clean the victim once every 24 hours per node. Then they reboot the victim client. We can see the clients will connect with the new IDs they take when the client reads. And then that new IDs will go into the client table. Okay, so because the client table is formed with the current IDs, so the client wants to see the other nodes. You can see the results is that the node kind of that first has the node with an iPhone 23 X, and the victim was in the New York. The techniques result was a 54 of 551. And then they test the fresh node, which is which has been online for 1 hour. The result is 33 of 53 tests. Yeah, so one is so I so then I have some method to solve this issue. The first one is no IDs, because right now the no IDs, the no ID was used the public place was generated from the this function, which was in the maybe two definition, and so it's all public, and the attacker can generate the fake ID, or the attacker can know where this ID was which market, which market. And then so the next one is public maybe from public. So it's you get 1.8, there can be also 10 attacker IDs, also maybe attacker ID address. The next one is makes it more aggressive, which means the knowledge always wants something when they recruit, and eliminate the recruit, it's for attention window. These are all updated in 1.8. So the next one is the techniques attacked by the internet account. This attack is aimed to erase the victim from the network. Since the UDP message will be rejected, timestamp is more than 20 seconds. So they can attack the MTP or change the victim's card. So in this experiment, they update the victim's card forward into the 25 seconds and the 5 minutes, and the 7 minutes and the 9 minutes and the 13 minutes. So you can see there's a picture. The bit size and the number of connections for so the red line was the victim's card was the phone number for the victim's card, and so you can see that during 13 minutes there are two connections for the victims. So it's not saying you only have two peers connections. So they suggest this answer instead of timestamp when the user side a peer message. Which get even up so because it's not working in the RLP before. It looks like the nonce. So the get so you can't even use the updates for the get. Next, I'm going to introduce all content, the bad tile movements about Greek terrorism or bad plans to verify the blockchain network. And then about we have an incentive for the nodes to transfer the data of the hands of the device. Because we are the centralized API, so we have the hands of the device. And then we are more lower cost and more secure. Okay, so what is about Greek? It's this is an algorithm that is invented by our CEO company. And first, we'll make a map for miners consumption in maybe 100 watts. And then we'll validate the last 100 watts. The given block was confirmed by miners. That's the only percent of the proportion is bigger than 51%. And yes, the network will be ready if the net is 100 blocks are validated. Which means the number percentage of the proportion are more bigger than. For example, if we have the miner ABCD in the first 100 blocks, and then we can count the proportion of the miner. The N might be 30, the A is 30% in this example, the B is 25%, and the C is 30%, and it's 45%. So we can see the block E is very because the sum of the proportion of the following blocks A and B is bigger than 51%. Demo?
Yes.
Ah, one.
Yes, please.
here I'm going to start the top of the local proxy server.
Oh, it works. Yeah. it's on the whole video stream was going through the guide video from our listening pod, which was in our tiny office.
Can you explain it says to connect into Asia, Europe, and USA, and then this Raspberry Pi from Taipei? So what's the connection between Raspberry Pi and Taipei and US and Europe?
We use a publisher in Taipei, which will connect to only one node at one time. So, because the Taipei is more close to the Asian node,
So we just connect to the HML. And then in this proxy, we connect to our nodes, which is the HML and the Europe node and the USA node. Because we want to, because we want to push the connection from the original to the proxy. Yeah, so PyPy is connecting to the channel. Hope you can download and try it out and give us some feedback.
Can I ask a question about you?
You still ask a question right now.
Is that the this that didn't update the timestamp because the RLP4 can only use nouns?
Oh, no. Oh, sorry. So, yeah, so it comes to RLP4 use timestamp.
Oh, and yes. It's the, like, the protocol is so old and we cannot change it or
this is addressed to this addressed to discovery pipe. I think so because you have the ENR records and I think there's a signed IP there somewhere, maybe. I'm not sure.
Yeah, really
good. Maybe not. I'm not sure.
Okay. Sorry.
Because this was a boy with Felix Lange, right? And he's working on story by so.
Yeah.
Well, one question on the NTP attack, like how easy is that to do? Because I looked at the prep and it seemed to be referring to not, like how easy is it to, how can I change the clock? Like is that an easy attack to do or, yeah, I did not catch that. I mean, it seems terrible if you can do that, but how does that go?
It's not high. But they didn't mention it in the paper, so I think it's hard to check the NTP server. But maybe you can use maybe they hijack the network for the device, and then they take the NTP server.
Right, the DNS.
So you can change.
Did you remember the Do you remember the prismatic lab testnet and the,
the Google clock.
And the clock failed and then all their nodes went
the
down.
Is that any more? Do we want like a 5 minute break and then do the Davis talk or should we keep going? 5 minute break.
Okay.
Okay.